Thank you for your patience. In beginning the program, I'd first like to acknowledge the working people who made it possible. Of course, the sponsoring organizations from this institution that includes the Social Science Division, the Special Programs Division, the Student Services Division, the Humanities Division, the Library, and the President's Office. Then we have Friends World College, who came up with the idea for this particular program for tonight. We have the Panamanian Political Organization of New York, which even though that is a recent name in terms of an umbrella, a group of people who have been functioning together much longer than the organization itself. We have very specific people who have done the work, Mrs. Alex Alexander, Yvonne Bennett, Danish Yazani, Dowage Hunter, who brought the program to Medgar, and Zala Chandler. I also would like to recognize Rafael Zambrana and Sazine Hard-Nikulescu, chairs of the Library and Division of Social Sciences. Now, having done the official thank yous, let us begin. This is part of a continuing series that we're having on world affairs around the question of world peace. World peace because peace is what we all want in this world, and peace is what is necessary if we are to prosper and develop in the ways that we all want to develop as individuals and as nations. The more particular aspect of tonight is obviously the question of national sovereignty and equality between nations. I couldn't help but think in terms of looking at the history of Panama in relationship to the United States, because we are interested in examining issues related to United States foreign policy, that in terms of the question of equality and national sovereignty, that at least since the late 1890s, the question of equality between nations and the question of national sovereignty has been a major issue in terms of looking at Panama. We don't need to go into the history of Panama, but it's clear in terms of the canal zone politics, the relationship to Colombia when Panama was a part of Colombia, that the United States has not always thought of, or not always acted as if Panama is both a sovereign nation and Panama is a nation of equals. In the world court, equality is not a function of economic power, it's not a function of militarism, but it's a function that just as human beings are equal because they are equal by birth, whether you want to do that biblically or not, they are equal by birth, and that nations too are equal by birth. That when we talk about equality, it cannot be or should not be based on the old adage, might makes right. So as we come here together to deal with these critical issues, let us keep in mind that what we are talking about is equality in a true sense of the form. What we are talking about is national sovereignty in the true sense of the form. And that as we move forward in the discussion, and for those of you who ask questions in the end, keep in mind always, Panama is a free and independent state. And any deliberation which we have around the question of Panama and the United States of America must see them both as free, independent, equal nations in the Americas. Now I will introduce the person who takes the program forward from here, Gilbert Camargo, who is student executive for Friends World College.
Thank you, Dan. This is the first time that Friends World College and Medgar Evers College work together in a presentation like this, and we're very pleased to do so. In continuing with the same subject that Dan brought up, I think we all here agree that the issue of Panama is an issue of achieving peace. What the question tonight should be, if the solution of the Panamanian struggle is one based on the development of internal democracy and national sovereignty, on a relationship of equality with the United States, or is it going to be one based on a continuous status of dependency under the umbrella of the Pentagon? We also should take a look at the internal and external political problems of Panama and see where are they are different and where they are, if these problems are separate or different issues of equal importance. We have some major changes in the program today, and I would like to explain those. Professor Miguel Bernal is here from the University of Panama. He's professor of law at the University of Panama. He was expected to be in the program. Professor Cecilia Simmons is also present. But unfortunately, Congressman Ted Wise had to be called back to Congress and could not take part in this panel. Also, Mr. Walter Bastuart of the Panamanian Political Organization of New York could not be present because he also had to go to Washington. And Professor Luisa Martin from the same organization will take his place. We'll be sharing the moderating of this panel with Robert Knight, for co-producer of Contract A WBI program. Robert?
Thank you, Gilman. I was born American, but as I've delved deeper into learning about Panama, I feel more and more Panamanian. I'd like to just begin with just a very brief acknowledgement of history in our efforts to achieve a righteous future in Panama, the United States, and the rest of the world. And I'm reminded of the similarity between current events and the establishment of the state of Panama in 1903. In both cases, there were two United States warships off the coast, as there are in 1988. And there is, in fact, taking place through the government of the United States, the recognition of a second government of Panama. Another historical irony that might be considered is a statement of Senator Robert Dole, who said before Congress that we have reports that the military leader of Panama is involved in money laundering and drug smuggling, and that he is in collusion with Fidel Castro, the dictator of Cuba. And we should therefore not be engaged in any relinquishing of the Panama Canal. Robert Dole made that statement in 1977. And the reference was, of course, to Omar Torrijos. The timing of the recognition of the problems of corruption and drugs is most curious in the case of the United States, because the Justice Department of Edwin Meese, which found itself unable to prosecute any of the numerous allegations of Contra involvement in drugs, including a memorandum of indictment that was stifled by the Justice Department regarding a March 5th, 1986 arms shipment out of Florida, did manage on the 5th of February to unseal the indictments on money laundering and drug smuggling against General Manuel Noriega on the 5th of February, 2 days before Senator Kerry's hearings on narco-terrorism began to reveal a more extensive pattern of United States involvement in collusion with, looking the other way from, drug smuggling in the national interest. We find that as a result of this effort to solve a personnel problem in Panama, as it's viewed from Washington, that the justice system of the United States was used as a crowbar to achieve a change in Panama, a change that would continue the operation of the Southern Command, the United States' most important military base in this hemisphere. Are you a speaker or a listener? The facts I'm presenting can be checked by those who are interested in information. The justice system of the United States has become one of a number of weapons used to affect changes in Panama. Those changes, from the perspective of the United States government, have been ineffective thus far in removing General Noriega. However, the economy of Panama has been crippled, perhaps permanently. The economy of Panama has been crippled, perhaps permanently. The people have suffered from a battle between giants. We are here today to understand the responsibility of ourselves and our own government in light of the persistent struggle of the Panamanian people for independence and autonomy. And that struggle is impossible without a recognition of history. Thus, I am extraordinarily proud to be a member of this panel, a moderator of this panel, and to first present from Panama University, Cecilio Simmons, who is the Dean of Public Administration and Commerce at the University of Panama. Please welcome
him. Just one minor announcement. It's possible that any of the speakers might need a translator, and Ms. Esmeralda Brown will be doing that translation if we need it.
I want to explain why I want to speak in Spanish, because my English is not so fluid as who live in the United States and struggle for United States government to take over power in Panama. I'm a born Panamanian from three generations that work in Panama to let the canal that the United States use and the world commerce use could be constructed. I'm descendant from the black man that worked and gave his blood to construct this canal. And I worked for that black man rights in Panama. I also worked in Panama for the labor, for the peasant, for the poor men to have their rights. And that's why I want to be clear this night, and I'm going to speak in Spanish. That is my language. Hablar de Panamá se puede enfocar desde diversas maneras.
To speak about Panama, it can be focused within in the context of different ways.
Hay quienes dicen que Panamá es el país de los vagos.
There are those who say that Panama is the country of the vagos.
The vagabonds.
The vagabonds.
The lazy peoples.
The lazy.
Es el país de los que llegan una hora tarde a sus compromisos.
It's the country where people might get reached to a place an hour late to their commitment.
Pero también es el país que más ha luchado por su soberanía en este siglo.
But it's also the country that has struggled for his sovereignty in this century.
Y es precisamente sobre ese tema que quiero empezar a conversar con ustedes.
And it's precisely this theme that I would want to talk to you about.
Entre panameños es muy difícil ponernos de acuerdo sobre cuál debe ser nuestra relación con los Estados Unidos.
Within Panamanians, it is very difficult for us to decide what should be our relationship with the United States.
Pues ciertamente existe una corriente anexionista que desde principio de siglo ha pretendido que seamos una colonia de los Estados Unidos.
There has been a current within the Panamanian, within Panama, that we should be an annexionist to the United States.
Afortunadamente, esa es una corriente minoritaria.
Fortunately, this is a minority current within our country.
Yo quiero recordar las palabras de Elliot Root, quien en 1908 le decía a una comitiva panameña en el Departamento de Estado.
I would like to recall the words of Elliot Root, who in 1908 said the following.
El día que el gobierno de los Estados Unidos decida quién va a ser el gobernante de Panamá y el día que el gobierno de los Estados Unidos decida cómo van a estructurarse las instituciones panameñas, ese día habréis perdido vuestra independencia.
He said the day that the government of the United States is going to decide who is the government of Panama, the day that the government of the United States is going to structure the government of Panama, that day we would have lost our sovereignty.
Eso se lo decía a un grupo de ese sector anexionista que en 1908 pedía la intervención de los Estados Unidos en los asuntos electorales de Panamá.
That was said in 1908, that day when that annexionist sector was debating the issue of Panama.
Hoy día nosotros nos encontramos con una situación similar cuando otro sector anexionista pretende que los Estados Unidos resuelva los asuntos internos de Panamá.
Today we are faced with the same situation as 1908, where you have an annexionist, and I'm wondering if I'm using the right word in terms of annexionist. I think I am. Or in fact, people who want to be annexed to the United States.
Este sector ha pretendido resolver los problemas de Panamá con la intervención de los Estados Unidos en los asuntos internos, tal como señalaba hace un momento.
This sector attempts to resolve the problems of Panama. My mind went off.
A través de la intervención.
Oh, I'm sorry. This sector has attempted to solve the problem of Panama through an intervention posture.
Para ello, un señor que dice ser reconocido y que en efecto dice el gobierno de Estados Unidos que reconoce como presidente, ha solicitado la intervención contra Panamá.
For this, they have accepted what it has been said that this person represents, which should be an intervention of Panama.
Y lo dramático de la situación es que la intervención de los Estados Unidos no se hizo esperar y efectivamente se ha desatado toda una serie de calamidades contra el pueblo panameño. In effect.
In effect. Maybe if someone could help me, my mind is not there.
Yes,
unless
yes.
I read from your.
No, I'm not reading.
Let me try once again. Okay, repeat alone and I'll try.
You want to help me, Rupert?
My mind is blank, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Most dramatically of the situation is
que este sector,
that this sector
que pretende gobernar a Panamá,
ha
desatado a nombre de la democracia, a nombre de la libertad,
in name of democracy, in terms of liberty,
una serie de calamidades contra el pueblo panameño,
a series of atrocities against the Panamanian people,
que se traduce en un 30% de desempleo en estos momentos.
That translates into 30% unemployment.
Eso ha duplicado la cifra del desempleo en el año que tenía Panamá el año pasado en solo 3 meses.
This has doubled the percentage of unemployment for the last 3 months.
Igualmente este sector
equally
ha cortado a través de la mano de los Estados Unidos el flujo de dinero, lo cual ha quebrado las empresas que ellos mismos representan.
Has shortened by, through the United States the flow of cash that the enterprise that they represent.
Es por ello que nosotros consideramos de que no está en juego únicamente la situación de el cambio de un gobernante.
This is why we consider that a change in government,
que no es lo que está realmente en juego.
It is not the issue.
Para ello,
for this,
voy a presentar un documento.
I will present to you,
suscrito por el secretario asistente de asuntos intergubernamentales.
A document.
El secretario asistente de asuntos intergubernamentales y legislativos del Departamento de Estados.
A document of the.
Bueno, Assistant Secretary.
I have problem with the title. Assistant Secretary
yes.
of the State.
Somebody that works in State Department. Okay? Bien. Yes. His name is Edward Fox, and his name nor his charge are not invented.
I don't need to translate that.
Thank you. He wrote that this letter to Jesse Helms, the 26th of March, 1987. Don't leave me, please. Dice el señor Edward Fox, el 26 de marzo de 1987.
On March 28, 1987.
El Departamento de Estado comparte su punto de vista.
The Department of State agree with your point of view.
En cuanto a los tratados, de que cuando los tratados Torrijos-Carter sean renegociados.
Insofar as the treaties of will be renegotiated, I can get to that.
La permanencia de la presencia militar de los Estados Unidos en el área del Canal de Panamá, más allá del 2000, debe ser incluida como tema de discusión.
The presence of the United States in the Panama Canal should be a point of discussion.
Igualmente señala el señor Fox que el mantenimiento del poder de los sandinistas en Nicaragua, las actividades de los insurgentes salvadoreños, estoy leyendo textualmente la traducción de la carta, y la influencia cubana comunista en la región hacen urgentemente necesario que los Estados Unidos fortalezcan su posición en América Central.
By the same token, the power of the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, the activities of the insurgents in Salvador, the influence of communist Cuba in the region makes it urgent that the United States fortify their position in Central America.
Continúa señalando el señor Fox, y estoy leyendo toda la carta que son tres párrafos, la continua polarización de las fuerzas políticas en Panamá pueden conducir a una crisis en ese país que representaría una seria amenaza a la estabilidad de la región.
As stated by Senor Fox, the continuous polarization of the political forces in Panama may be conducive to a crisis in that country that will represent a menace to the stability of the region.
Quiero que ahora me traduzca lo mejor posible lo que viene porque quiero subrayarlo. El Departamento de Estado es de la opinión que para evitar tal situación se deben tomar pasos que conduzcan a la renuncia del general Noriega como comandante en jefe de la Guardia Nacional y el establecimiento de un gobierno interino integrado por políticos de una mentalidad moderada e igualmente oficiales militares de alto rango quienes vean sus como sus principales objetivos, subrayo, la promoción del proceso de democratización y la salvaguarda de los intereses estratégicos de los Estados Unidos.
The Department of the State is of the opinion that to remedy the situation, it is necessary to take steps that will be conducive to the resignation of General Noriega as Commander-in-Chief of the National Guard and the establishment of an interim government composed by politicians of a mentality that is moderate and officials equal to the officials in high military ranks and that their principal objectives is the promotion of the process of democratization and the safeguards of the interests, of the strategic interests of the United States.
Yo quiero que usted sepa, concluyo señalando el senador Fox, que estos problemas es plenamente apreciado en la Casa Blanca y que aquí en el Departamento de Estado se tomarán pasos eficaces para lograr resolverlos.
Concludes Mr. Fox that he would like everybody to know that the real importance of these problems are appreciated in the White House and here in the Department of State and that steps will be taken, efficient steps will be taken to resolve them.
De forma tal que la situación de Panamá, que efectivamente ha sido pintada como una situación de confrontación entre un gobierno y un hombre al cual se le ha acusado de una serie de elementos que quizás puedan ser ciertos o quizás no puedan ser ciertos. En realidad, está debatiendo los intereses estratégicos de los Estados Unidos señalado por Edward Fox en su carta.
The situation is such that anyone can say that the allegations are true or maybe false, but in reality, it is a reaffirmation of Mr. Fox's statement in his letter.
¿Cuáles son los intereses estratégicos de los Estados Unidos en Panamá?
What are the interests of the United States in Panama?
En primer lugar, y
in
obviamente,
place,
está el interés militar.
It is the military interest.
Con la negociación
with
de
negotiations,
los tratados de desarme nuclear con la Unión Soviética,
of the nuclear negotiations with the Soviet Union,
los Estados Unidos ha tenido que replantear su política militar.
The United States has to rephrase their military politics.
Restructure.
Restructure.
Thank you.
The military policy, I'm sorry.
Para tal efecto, la política de despliegue nuclear ha sido replanteada por la política de la guerra de baja intensidad y la política de despliegue de tropas convencionales.
For this,
I get that. Too much. Say it again.
Para tal efecto,
to this effect,
se ha planteado. ¿Ok? Se ha planteado que, como política de Estados Unidos, el despliegue de tropas convencionales, el despliegue de tropas convencionales y la guerra de baja intensidad para replantear pues su política militar en el área, ellos requieren de la presencia en Panamá y de sus tropas convencionales en Panamá.
I'm getting out of gas.
Why you don't help me, Daddy?
I need
come on, Daddy, come on. Help me. Sí. Pero no importa. ¿Quién me ayuda? Muchas gracias. ¿Ah? Sí. Sí.
Bueno, pero usted tiene que ver más despacio, frase por frase, porque a mí se me olvida la cosa, ¿no?
Perfecto.
Okay.
Ajá. Muchas gracias. Decía que la política militar de los Estados Unidos hace referencia directamente a la situación de Panamá.
I said that the military politics of the United States is directly related to the problem of Panama.
Los Estados Unidos, lo saben todos los que están aquí presentes, tienen grandes intereses estratégicos desde el punto de vista militar en Panamá.
Everybody knows here that the interest of the United States in Panama has very important military interests.
En primer lugar, cabe mencionar la existencia de la isla Galetas.
In the first place, I have to mention the island of the Galetas in Panama.
Este es un centro localizado en el Atlántico.
This is a center that's located in the Atlantic Ocean.
Y que es utilizado.
And it is being used
para la intercomunicación de los submarinos nucleares y convencionales de los Estados Unidos.
It's being used for communication between the submarines of the United States.
Esta, la isla Galeta, y el área donde está la isla Galeta,
the area where the island is,
es el único lugar en el mundo, de acuerdo a los estudios que se han hecho,
according to the studies which have been made,
que tiene capacidad de transmitir a baja frecuencia,
that has the capacity of transmitting at a very low power,
frequency. A 80 pies de sumersión,
from 80 feet of submersion,
hacia ambos océanos,
to both oceans.
Ello posibilita, como señalaba, la comunicación entre los submarinos nucleares y
this
los convencionales.
This makes possible communication between the ordinary submarines, conventional submarines, and nuclear submarines.
Thank you. Está igualmente la base aérea de AWAR, que ellos tienen dentro de sus intereses estratégicos.
Howard Air Force Base. Repite eso, por favor.
Sí, la base aérea de Howard.
The Howard Air Force Base.
Que es capaz de recibir.
Is able to receive.
Y acomodar todos los sistemas aéreos, estratégicos, nucleares y convencionales.
Receive all the signals, both strategic, conventional, from the air and all over.
Yeah, thank you. Es la base aérea más grande que tiene los Estados Unidos fuera de su territorio continental.
This is the largest Air Force base the United States has outside of the continental United States.
Igualmente está el Fuerte Clayton.
Also in the same capacity as Fort Clayton.
Fuerte Clayton está destinados a reubicar las fuerzas de tierra que actualmente están diseminadas en 8 bases militares en Panamá.
Fort Clayton has the job of, repita eso por favor,
de reubicar, de concentrar.
Bring them together again. All the territories.
Todas las fuerzas territoriales.
All the armed forces territories
que están.
Repita eso.
Oh, dos minutos, está bien. Que están concentrada en diversas bases militares.
All those territories that are located in different bases, military bases.
Mm-hmm. Y finalmente está Fuerte Sherman.
Finally, Fort Sherman.
Que ya me quedan dos minutos.
Fort Sherman.
Que están destinada a la preparación de las tropas que van a participar en el conflicto de baja intensidad con escenarios selváticos.
Fort Sherman is the place where that's been programmed to prepare the troops or the activities of the low intensity attack.
Struggle.
¿Qué más?
Que tenga ambientes selváticos. Okay. Es decir, para preparar las tropas que van a participar en guerras de baja intensidad con ambiente selvático.
All right. He says that Fort Sherman is the place where they're going to prepare this movement of low intensity to regain this territory.
Jungle warfare.
Jungle warfare. De la selva. Oh, all right.
En segundo lugar están los intereses económicos. No creo que lo puedo decir en dos minutos, pero en el periodo de preguntas y respuestas podría ampliar.
There's also a question of the economic situation, but we can't do it in 2 seconds. So we'd have to 2 minutes, so we have to do it later on.
Solamente quiero mencionar que existe.
I only want to mention that there exists.
Una confrontación.
A confrontation.
En el terreno económico.
In the economic field.
Entre los Estados Unidos y Japón,
between the United States and Japan,
que de una manera u otra se traslada a Panamá.
That one way or the other relates to Panama, or is being transferred to Panama.
En este sentido, por ejemplo,
in this sense, for example,
los Estados Unidos tienen en Panamá la tercera mayor concentración económica que tiene en América Latina.
The United States has in Panama the third greatest economic power in the world, in Panama.
In Latin America.
In Latin America.
Y en estos momentos,
in these moments,
los Estados Unidos ven en peligro esa presencia económica en Panamá por el embate de los japoneses.
The United States looks on the financial position of Japan as something that's in their disfavor.
Let me help myself now.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you. I know that there's many more aspects to present to you, but I believe this is the most important in this affair. I would like to know if the United States really want democracy for Panama, why they don't agree to leave Panama and let us make our own democracy. And that means that government force, independent force, and opposition force must sit down and discuss Panamanian problems without the presence of the United States. It's demonstrated that it's not a discussion between a man and a government. It's a discussion in between a country that want to keep their presence in my country, and we can't accept my country and your country. Okay.
Yeah.
May I just suggest something? This is indeed a public forum. Even though it is a public forum, we also have other people speaking. There will be plenty of time to engage in the types of interaction, shall we call it, that just happened. However, until we reach that point in the program, it is rude to everyone sitting here to insist that your voice must be heard. So I would request that you respect the other people sitting here and wait to that point in the program. Thank you.
I assure that any time Panamanians sit and discuss their problem, they will reach to agreement and they will get what they want, not what United States want. Thank you.
Because we are here to hear informed and distinguished speakers, we shall hear them. We pause now for a brief round of questions for the first speaker, Cecilio. I'm the victim of conflicting instructions.
I just wanted to ask
Gilman.
Professor Simmons, that he really talk about the external situation of Panama. Would you like to say a few words about the internal situation of Panama? My question is...
Just a minute.
Would you like...
Let Mr. Bernard speak and then I will answer all your questions.
Okay.
There's an exercise that I once learned in times of stress and confusion, which involves simply taking a deep breath. Would you join me in that? All right.
Okay.
All right. Now that we are focused again, let us please move forward to our next distinguished guest, a scholar in exile from Panama, Dr. Miguel Bernal, who is the editor of Alternativa and also the author of two books, including The Torrijos-Carter Treaty, A Historic Betrayal, and Militarism and the Administration of Justice. Please welcome Miguel Bernal.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to be tonight with you here. I also would like to speak in Spanish, who is my language, but I took just a few moments ago the decision to speak in my really bad English. Because I think that is the best way to give you my exactly opinion and minds and talks about the situation. Certainly, if in some time I don't find the word in English, I am going to ask you. I apologize myself because I don't speak the English very well as I like to do it, but I think that you can understand what I want to say because we are, I think, all of us, or the majority of us, Panamanians also. That's okay? Bien. I think that as a Panamanians, and as a Panamanian who have an interest in our country, and your presence here is the best support for this, we cannot deny the history of Panama. And we know very well how difficult it is for Panama as a country, for Panama as a people, and for Panama as a nation, his relations with the United States governments during the last 85 years. I think that the United States intervention in Panama, militarily, economic, political, and social and cultural interventions, are knowed by all of us. We cannot deny the importance and how difficult it is for us to continue to build our nation with the permanent United States intervention in our internal affairs. But we cannot deny also that we live in an international society, and it is our responsibility to stop this intervention. It's our responsibility to arrive to have a real and a good relation with the United States people, and to obtain a respect for our people from the United States governments. But in this moment, we have in Panama a very special situation who do not start 1 year ago. A situation who do not begin after last February, when Noriega was indicted by a Florida tribunal in the United States. A situation where the drugs trafficker is a consequence, is not a cause of our problems. A situation where Noriega is also a consequence, but is not the cause of our problems. And we need to understand that first, if we want really to start also to resolve our own problems without any kind of intervention. Okay? The problem that we have in this moment is not a problem between the Panamanians and the United States. Because the problem between the Panamanians and the United States started November 3, 1903, not with the indictment. And the majority of the problems that we have now, in my personal opinion, the majority of the problem that we have now, we can found the answer of the different question that we have in the Torrijos-Carter treaties were agreed with this military presence that Professor Simons denounced, as I and other people in Panama we denounce, not now, but all our life. Because it's the Torrijos-Carter treaties who agreed that the United States can intervene militarily in Panama. That is necessary to be reminded. In the Panama Canal Treaties, 1977, this government, the same government that we have in Panama now, the military government, because Noriega is in power, not as a head of the Panamanian Defense Force, but is in power with the military regime since 1968. And since 1969, he is at the head of the G2. That means the security policy who make repression in Panama during all these 15 years that he was at the head of the G2. And as we learned, some people perhaps learned now, Noriega since 1966 works for the CIA. In the Torrijos-Carter treaties, they said, notwithstanding the provisions of Article 5 or any other provision of the treaty, if the canal is closed or its operation are interfered with, the United States and the Republic of Panama shall each independently have the right to take such steps as each deems necessary in accordance with its constitution, including the use of military force in the Republic of Panama to reopen the canal or restore the operation of the canal as the case may be. And Senator De Concini, in 1977, when he presented another amendment to the Carter-Torrijos Treaty, he spoke very clear and he said, that means that we can intervene in Panama when we want, militarily, politically, socially, or economically. And who signed these treaties is the same military regime who is in power in Panama now, doing different things, more things against the Panamanian people, because the economic crisis in Panama do not started a month ago when the United States government takes sanctions against Panama. And I do not agree with the economic sanctions that the United States took against Panama, because these economic sanctions are against the Panamanian people and not against Noriega. These economic sanctions are making the Panamanian people to suffer more. But why they take the economic sanctions? I have my personal opinion, because at that moment, the popular movement, the popular struggle against the militarism, not only against Noriega, because Noriega is, okay, is the head of the military regime, but the struggle against the militarism in Panama was growing. And the best way to stop the struggle of the people of Panama was to put the people in a more economic and social situation, difficulty situation, because after the economic sanctions, people without money or without foods cannot go immediately to the streets to continue their different kind of demonstrations against the government. Also, I think that it's necessary to mention that certainly I agree that it's to the Panamanian people to resolve our problem. But why we cannot resolve our problem by ourselves? Because during the last 20 years, with the military regime, they don't permit us to discuss between us our problems. Because we don't have all our freedoms. Because they want to put us in a struggle between us, between the people. They put the people to struggle against the people. And as I said, the economic crisis do not start a month ago. 1 year ago, our economic situation was really very difficult also. More than 27% of unemployment. The country with the most important national debt per capita in the world, more than Israel. And that was before June 1987, not yesterday or a month ago. Also, our social problems, I would like to ask to the military government of Panama to present us what they did for the poor in Panama, for the people in Panama. We are all Panamanians, and we know what happens in Panama. The social problems in all the Casas Brujas is not resolved. The corruption and all the problems that you know better than mine, perhaps. That do not mean that there are not people in Panama who don't want to resolve these problems. But the problem is that if you want in Panama, before we have Rabi Blancos, and now we have also Rabi Verdes. And the Rabi Negros and Rabi Prietos don't have nothing. And the other poor people don't have nothing. And the situation is more and more difficult for all the Panamanian people. It is true that Panama is a country who struggled for our sovereignty. But what's happened is, for the first time in our history, a treaty legalized the military bases. Never before, the 1977 treaties, the military base were legalized in Panama. Also, it is true that the United States have plenty of military bases in Panama, and not only in Galeta, in plenty of places. But who agreed with that? This military regime. And as different members of the United States government mentioned in different opportunities, before Torrijos and after Torrijos' death, when they said that they were sure that only with a military government they can obtain all the things that they obtained from the Panamanian government, but not with a democratic government in Panama. I think that our situation is very difficult, it's very hard, and we need to be more consensus about this situation and to start how to resolve the problem. In my opinion, it is necessary if we want to discuss as Panamanians. We need to finish with the military regime who prevent us to discuss. We need to have democratic freedoms who are going to permit us to struggle. We cannot struggle against the United States government and his policy in our country if we don't have our own freedoms to discuss that. Noriega now presents himself as a victim of the United States. And it's very easy to do that. It's very funny to see him with the Panamanian flag always in the bad side. Always in the bad side to present himself, to present himself as a victim of the United States. The same Noriega that in 1984, 1985, 1986, 1987, after he took the head of the National Guard, organized maniobras conjuntas, that means joint maneuvers, militaries, with the United States, Kindle Liberty 1, Kindle Liberty 2, Kindle Liberty 3, 4, 5, all the Kindle Liberties. The same Noriega that, as different journalists here in the United States, accuse not Noriega alone, but also other people like Bush in the United States to work together against the Nicaragua government, against the other governments in Latin America. Poindexter? Pardon? Abrams, okay, Abrams. ¿Qué le pasó a Abrams? Abrams. Yeah, I know that he is the assistant of the Secretary of State for Latin America. And we can talk about Abrams, certainly. But our problem is not, in this moment, only Abrams. I want to mention that plenty of people from this administration met with Noriega during all these years to organize different kind of activities against other peoples and also against our people. Anyway, I have 2 minutes, but I want to mention that we need to be very clear about different things. In my opinion, Panama is not Noriega, and we cannot make a confusion between the Noriega problems with his former boss or employees and the problems that we have as a country and as a nation and as a people. Also, I think that the United States needs to leave Panama, certainly, certainly. But who permits the United States to station troops until the year 2000 and after the year 2000 if the Torrijos-Carter treaties? It's not the Panamanian people, because we need to remind also that in 1977, when they signed the Panama Canal treaties, in Panama we don't have any kind of freedoms, political parties, radio stations, or newspapers to struggle against the Panama Canal treaties. I think that our situation, the residents in Panama these days, I think that they feel, and we feel, like participants in a Roman circus battle between Christians and lions. The Christians are played by Panamanians, the lions by members of the PDF and different US agencies like CIA, like Pentagon, like Drugs Enforcement Agency, like banks, certainly, and the Roman spectators by people throughout the world. The spectators root for the Christians, but they know who will win, the lions. Why? Because the Panamanian people don't have any kinds of instruments to continue or to maintain their struggle against the military regime. I think that if we are going to struggle for a liberation, we cannot say that we need to finish first with the United States and after with the militarism. I think that if we struggle against the militarism, we can prevent it for the next generations, the situation that we have had during the last 20 years in our country. And we can prevent it also that in our next relations with the United States, they can continue to put our country in a second place or in a third place or in a 16th or 18th place in our relations in this continent. Before finish, I think that in the same way that we cannot accept the United States impositions, we cannot accept Noriega's imposition. And in the same way that we cannot agree when some people want a military intervention in our country, we cannot agree to continue to present, as some people did in Panama, Noriega as a victim of the United States. The only victim of the United States now and yesterday and tomorrow is the Panamanian people, not Noriega. And also, it is true. It is true, and plenty of people mentioned that in Panama, why, and I agreed when Professor Simon says, why the Panamanian people cannot be seen to discuss the problems. Well, ask to this military regime who exiles people, who tortures people, who kills people, who prevent people to discuss the problems. If we want to build a nation, if we want to build a real society, we cannot think that we are going to build a society like the headquarters of the militaries, where the people are only, where the people can only do what the chief of the military says. And I finish. A society that means difference. A society that means different positions. A society that means also different kinds of political positions to be discussed. But a society doesn't mean that we need to agree all the time with all the people for all the matters. And a society, principally, that means that the civilians cannot be continued under the control of the military regime. A society, that means that the civilians need to take power, and the militaries needs to serve the civilians and not the civilians the military. And I think, to finish, that our problem is that 20 years ago in Panama, certainly with plenty of difficulties, we have had a National Guard who served the country and a special interest of some people. But now the problem is worse, because now we have an army who have a country for their own purpose and not for the purpose of the Panamanian people. Thank you.
Dr. Miguel Bernal is the editor of Alternativa. And now we move to a representative of the Panamanian political organization, Professor Luisa Martin.
I don't know I'm going to follow this thing, man. Oh, wow. Dr. Kelly mentioned the particular tonight of tonight's presentation was going to deal with equality and sovereignty of a nation in the true sense of the word. I was sitting there and hearing a battle, and I didn't hear a sense of discussing equality and sovereignty of a nation. Before I go on, I want to just clear up something, and that is, I believe that Professor Bernal, as I heard, is self-exile. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if that's true. But I'm almost sure that it's not exile, it's self-exile, which makes things different. And before I go on, I'm going to talk a little bit about... No. I'm just making comments, all right? I'm making some comments, and they're going to have the opportunity to respond. Something happened in Panama. General Omar Torrijos decided to free Panama from the oligarchies. That process revolutionized Panama to now, when they have decided that it's enough. They want the power back. What he did was, he gave the power to the people. We had Indian leaders in key positions. We have blacks in key positions. We have campesinos in key positions that did not happen before 20 years ago. Furthermore, he did something crazy. He invented a PRD party. And that PRD party includes everybody. I don't know what people are talking about that there's no representation. The PRD party has everything in there, because according to General Torrijos' vision, he thought that Panama's sovereignty and independence would come from the including the process of everybody involved in Panama. He even involved the little Communist Party that they have in Panama. What more do you want? PRD party is a conglomeration of all the parties. The treaty. We can talk about the treaty. General Omar Torrijos visualized that until the Panama Canal Treaty was signed, we were getting, what is it that you give your kids once a week? Allowance. We were getting allowance from the United States. In order for the for Panama's economy to be successful for Panama, then Panama has to run the Panama Canal and obtain that benefit that comes from getting the economic power from that venture. So, although he made some mistakes, yes, he did, because as Professor Bernal said, The Consigne Enmienda, which is what he spoke about, legalized military base in Panama. I guess what he was depending on was the goodwill of the American government. But the Panama Canal, giving back the Panama Canal to Panama, means the total sovereignty of a nation, means equality, which is what we came here to discuss tonight. On March 29, Norman Bailey, a former National Security Council staff person, told the congressional hearing that they're going to have to get rid of Noriega. But he also said that that will not solve the problem. You know why? Because to start solving the problem, he said, you have to root out the problem of the Panamanian Defense Force. It has to be reduced to 1/2 to 2/3 of the entire high command, and the entire high command would have to be replaced by whom? I don't know. What does that mean? Well, it shows us the reality of the United States war in Panama. The treaty, and also on the treaty, that will have to be returned. The Panama Canal that would have to be returned in the year 1999. It shows that the election that is coming up in 1989, the United States wants to have a handle on it. They talk about the Panamanian government stealing the election in 1984. They talk about that. The United States government, leave her. She got to vent her feelings. There.